We're going to be reading Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16. Should be on your study guide. It simply says, when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias or Elijah, and some others or Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. He saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. Let's talk about who Jesus is tonight. Let's pray. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. And God, we ask you to be with us in this class. We ask that the ladies in the fellowship hall would be ministered to tonight. And we pray for the youth, Lord, that are going to be in this class, Lord. We pray also that your anointing would be on the children. And we pray that, God, your hand would be upon every breakout class that goes on, financial peace. And Lord, the Acts 2:38 and teaching them Bible studies and how to be about their father's business in working. We ask you, God, to have your way. And we thank you for all that you're doing and the way that you're doing it. We ask you to inhabit our praises as we lift up the name of Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Can you say in Jesus' name? Come on and put your hands together one more time for the Lord. Amen. Who is Jesus? The focus of this lesson is to properly identify the nature and personhood of Jesus Christ. And that's what we want to accomplish here tonight, is the nature and the personhood of Jesus Christ. It's going to be very interesting to some of you, and some of you may be a little old hat, but anytime I'm teaching something, it's a little bit different, so we want God to have his way. According to George Barna, Jesus Christ remains a central figure in the perennial or ongoing person of interest in America, in American religious landscape, especially in the days leading up to Easter. On Sunday, March 29, 2015, the National Geographic Channel premiered its adaptation of Bill O'Reilly's book, Killing Jesus, to 3.7 million viewers, the channel's biggest audience in history. CNN's Finding Jesus miniseries also sustained impressive viewership. Google search of Jesus Christ climbed to about 53% leading up to Easter. What are you trying to say here? That there's a lot of interest about this one that we serve and that we're actually living for every single day. And maybe in this lesson or maybe in this series or this series of talk here, you're going to get something that's going to awaken inside of you and cause you to serve the Lord and not take him for granted. Who wants to know Jesus just a little bit better? And once you get to know him, yeah, I was talking to someone just yesterday, and I talked to somebody else about it as well, is that there's five things that you need to understand about living for God. Number one, you've got to be totally sold out and totally convinced and totally in the will of God. Every single person in here should know that you're in the will of God. And when you're in the will of God, it doesn't matter about the circumstances. It doesn't matter about what goes on in your life. It doesn't matter what goes right or goes wrong. If you're in the will of God, you're able to endure it. And I'm going to tell you five things that will help you to stay in the will of God. And it's five things that we pretty much have adapted around here. And number one is that you love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. If you can love God with everything, he says this is the greatest commandment that you'll ever obey. And the second one is like it, to love your neighbor as yourself. In other words, love other people. And when you start loving other people and you start loving God just right, things start coming together. And the next thing that you need to do is that you need to attract people. That's ACE, we call it around here, acing people. And the first acronym there in the A is attracting people to Jesus Christ. And the fourth thing that needs to happen in your life is that you begin to equip. people, or you get equipped yourself. And once you start equipping people and teaching them and equipping them with the Word of God, then you want to send them to do the exact same thing that God has done for you and that you've helped them to do. So if you learn to ace people and to obey the Great Commission and the Great Commandment, the Great Commission, go into all the world, and the Great Commission is to love God and love people, and the Great Commandment is to love other people as yourself. Once you obey that, you're going to find yourself on the right track. Tonight, I will attempt to answer three questions concerning Jesus. Number one, the first question. Jesus asked his disciples, who do people say he was? Right on your study guide there. Who do people say he was? He was asking the audience of the day. So we've got to go back to first century thinking for just a minute. And you got to understand where they're coming from, a different culture. They're coming from a different religious culture, and they're looking at what Peter's saying and what Jesus is doing right here in a different frame mindset. They're looking through a different set of spectacles. In verse 13 and 14 of our scripture text, notice he, talking about Jesus, asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and some others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." So they had some idea, because it was prophesied that Isaiah was going to come back. It was prophesied that Moses was going to come back. And actually, it did happen, because on the Mount of Transfiguration, when Jesus was illuminated, remember that? When he was illuminated, who appeared to him on the Mount of Transfiguration? Moses and Elijah. So they had some thought of these Old Testament prophets coming back, and they said, well, people around here, the scuttlebutt is that you're John the Baptist, come back. Or you're Elias, come back. Or you're Jeremiah, come back. Or one of the other prophets. But, you know, they had a lot of ideas. The Barna Research Group points out two interesting facts. Fact number one, the vast majority of Americans, that's us, believe Jesus was a real person. The vast majority of the United States of America, we're not talking about third world countries and countries outside of here, but they believe that Jesus was an actual figure in history, a real person. On your study guide, 92% of all Americans believe this. 92% of all Americans surveyed believe that Jesus was a real person. 87% of millennials. You say, am I a millennial? If you're born between the years of 1982 to 2004, you're considered a millennial. Well, they kind of fluctuate, but it's right around in there. And millennials, about 87%, 91% of Generation Xers believe that Jesus was a real person. These are those that are born between 1965 in 1984, 95% of baby boomers believe that Jesus was a real person. These are those that are born between 1946 and 1964, which is my group, the Funk's group. We believe that Jesus, 95% of us believe that Jesus was an actual figure. And 96% of elders, those born from 1945 and earlier, that's the highest group, 96% of them believe that Jesus was an actual figure in history. Fact number two, younger generations are increasingly less likely to believe that Jesus was God. There's a dilution coming here. And you see where I'm going. There's a watering down, if you will. But the majority of millennials, this generation that's rising up, do not believe that Jesus Christ is God when surveyed. Barna goes on to say most adults, not quite six in ten, believe Jesus was God, about 56% of adults, while about one quarter say he was only a religious spiritual leader like Muhammad or Buddha. That's 26%. The remaining 1 in 6 say that they aren't sure whether Jesus was divine, about 18%. Millennials are the only generation out of all of them, the only generation among fewer than half believe Jesus was God, only 48%. About one-third of young adults, 35%, say instead that Jesus was merely a religious or spiritual leader, while 17% aren't sure what he was. In each other older generation, the belief in Jesus as divine or that he was God is more common, 55% of Gen Xers, 58% of boomers, and nearly two-thirds of elders, which is 62%, believe Jesus was God. So you see, from the older generation, what year were you born, elder? 52. His generation, 62%, believe that, man, Jesus was God. But now we get into this generation we're living in now, the millennial generation, it's diluting. They're taking away from the deity of Jesus Christ, that he's not God. This is something that was ingrained in the spirit and in the fiber and in the core of the apostolic faith and the core of Christianity from its very roots. And this is what shook the kingdom of hell and shook the kingdom of religiosity when Jesus stepped on the scene. We're going to see that tonight. Question number 2. Jesus wants to know, not only they ask, he said, who do men say I am? But Jesus wants to know, who do we, us, say he is here at Lighthouse of the Valley in this room right now? Anybody? You say he's the Son of God, Brother Tony, and God. Anybody else? Who is Jesus? The young generation, you guys can say it, it can be wrong too. It's fine in here to be wrong. Brother Aquino? He is the Lord of lords and King of kings. Anybody else? Brother Fong? He is God manifested, revealed in the flesh. Levi? He is the Word. Amen? Anybody else? Who is Jesus to you? I mean, when you heard what people are saying, you heard what they said of old time, and you heard what they're saying, but Jesus wants to know, what do you think? Who is he? Mark? He's Christ, okay? He's our Father, okay? He's my Father. We heard a message on that not too long about my Father, yeah. Anybody else? Who is Jesus to you? Okay? Those are all good. Notice, third question we're going to answer. Jesus asked his disciples, who did the disciples say he was? Who did the disciples say he was? We're going to read it real quick here, and then we'll get to that. In verse 15 of our scripture text, he, speaking about Jesus, saith unto them, his disciples, but whom do ye say that I am? And Peter stood up for the 11 that were there, and here's what he said. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood, notice, flesh, if it was just kind of something that you just kind of would pick up, it would be that easy. But he said, flesh and blood hath not revealed this unto thee. But notice, but my Father which is in heaven. So whatever Jesus is and whoever Jesus is, you cannot figure it out just by mere looking at him. He even said it who he was pretty much before he even told them that. But you cannot figure it out. He said, out of all the 11, they're a little bit afraid to say who he was. And they said, well, who do you think I am? And nobody spoke up. Nobody moved. But Peter, being bold as he was, he spoke up and he said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the... They might have been thinking of it. And he was speaking for them. But, you know, he was the only one bold enough to say, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then he made that statement. Man, how do you know that? And you and I take it for granted that, man, all you got to do is tell somebody who Jesus is and they get it. But it's not like that. It's got to be a revealed thing that who he is. Because if you're just reading the scripture, you're just watching and looking at the words. He said, these words that I speak to you, they're spirit and they're life. It's way more than that. And it takes a understanding from God to know who Jesus really is. Brother Funk, you're going to say something? Okay. According to the scriptures on your study guide, Jesus was identified as four things. And I heard it in here. He was identified as four things. Jesus was identified as the Christ. Everyone say the Christ. Right on your study guide there. He was identified as the Christ. The word Christ comes from the Greek word Christos, which means Messiah or anointed one. So he had a role to play here, and he had something he had to do. You know, Christ was not Jesus' last name. Okay? It was whatever Joseph's last name was. Okay? We don't know what that was. We don't know what Jesus' last name was. But Christ was his title. That's why when you talk about Jesus, you can say Jesus the Christ. Okay? Not just Jesus, but Jesus the Christ. In other words, the anointed one. Whenever you say the Christ, you're saying the anointed one's coming. Okay? Or the Messiah is coming. You know, some people, they'll even go deep enough, they won't even say the word, you know, Jesus before Christ. They'll just say Messiah, or they'll say Christ. And they're trying to make a point. I understand the point trying to be made, trying to separate the title from the individual. But you can't really separate the two. What you've got to understand is he had a role to play, and in his name, just connected to his name, he was the anointed one. He was the one prophesied from way back. He was the one prophesied from the Old Testament that was going to come, was going to be the seed of Jesse. He was going to be of the root of Jesse. He was going to rise up out of Jesse's house. He was going to be of the lineage of David. And that's why in Matthew, you'll see the lineage, it goes all the way back to Adam. Read it sometimes. It goes all the way back to Adam, but they were trying to show the genealogies and showing you how Jesus Christ not only identified from heaven, but he identified from earth. You know, there's only one mediator. Here's what the scripture says. There's only one go-between. So you don't have to come to pastor. You don't have to come to any of our clergy or any of our pastoral staff or anything. It's good to come to us for advice and everything, but you don't have to come to us for confessional. In other words, I'm not a go-between you and God, okay? It's a relationship between you and God. All I'm doing is kind of guide you along and herd you along. While at the same time, I'm trying to herd myself along, and I got to listen just like you got to listen. Okay, it's iron sharpening iron. We're sharpening each other. But here's the deal, that you don't have to go to a man, you don't have to go to a woman to get in contact with God. This is what they used to teach back way back in centuries gone by. And they taught that you have to come through a man to get to God. But here's what the Bible says. There's only one mediator. One. Everybody say there's only one mediator. This is a go-between. This is the one who's parlaying for you. This is the one that's negotiating for you. This is the advocate. This is the lawyer for the defense. This is the guy that goes into court and says, I'm representing you. It's only one mediator, one representative, one lawyer. There's only one lawyer to the defense, the man, Christ Jesus. In Scripture, wherever you see the word Christ, it's always, everybody say always. And it's never the opposite. It's always focusing on the humanity of Jesus Christ. And see, when I'm talking about going back in his lineage, you're going back all the way to Adam. And Adam was in the lineage of Jesus because it's in his humanness that he had to redeem man, not through his deity. Forget the deity right now, but just look at Jesus, the Christ, in his role as Messiah to do what? As deliverer to do what? As anointed one to do what? To bring us back to God. If any other way would have worked, God would have done it. If God could have just said, you know what? I'm going to come down and I'm going to wipe away all their sins. And anyone who really loves me, I can read their minds anyhow. I know what they're thinking even before they think it. I already know you're going to live for God. You're going to live for God. You're not going to live for God. And all you guys come on in. That's good enough. But no, God is so strategic and God is so kind and God is so orderly that he said, I'm going to have to make it so that a man has to redeem them. But he looked for a man. So who did he look to? He looked to Job. Job was perfect, upright in his generation. He looked to Enoch, who walked with God, but he was not, for God took him. He looked at Abraham. Abraham was called the friend of God. He looked at David, and David was a man after his own heart. And he said, none of them will do. What's the answer? The answer is, I've got to come. How do I do that? I've got to come as a man. I got to come. How am I going to do that? the Bible is so powerful that when you look at the scheme of things, God, not just remaining where he's at, where he did remain where he's at, but at the same time, he became a man. That's the great mystery. We're going to talk about that here in a little bit. But Christ, the anointed one. Number two, according to scriptures, Jesus was identified as Christ. And number two, Jesus was identified as the Son of God. The Son of the Almighty. Okay. Now, last time I looked, God doesn't have a wife. Okay. So he didn't like have, you know, well, you know, some people in different places, depends on where you're coming from, because you may be in here and you might be of a different religion or that believe that God has wives, because there are religions in our city that believe that God has wives, and that when you evolve or you get translated or you go into the new place where outside this earth, that you're going to have wives too, okay? And so, and just like God, and then you're going to evolve into a higher form of spirit, and you'll be God yourself. We don't believe that. But last time I looked, he doesn't have a wife. So how did Jesus become the Son of God? Anybody? How did Jesus become the Son of God? Help me out here. He was begotten, meaning, thank you. The Holy Spirit did what? Planted a seed in the virgin who was called Mary. Bible says the Spirit overshadowed Mary. And she was found without her knowledge. She was found with child. How? And that's when it was told her that she's pregnant. She was like, how could this thing be? Why? Because what? What? No, she said, how can this thing be, me being pregnant, because what? Immaculate conception, pretty much, yes? Because I never knew a man. In other words, I never have been with a man intimately to be able to conceive a child. How can this thing be? Pastor Robinson? Okay, Luke 1, 34 and 35. How can this be? Me not knowing a man, but yet I'm pregnant, not by a man, but by God. And what was the means in which God impregnated her? Is through the Holy Ghost, through the Spirit of God. The Bible says there's only one Spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in that spirit and truth. It says in John chapter 4, verse 24, it says that there's only one Spirit. And we must worship him in that spirit and in truth, for God is a spirit. This word spirit means Holy Spirit or Holy Ghost. Whenever you hear the term Holy Spirit or Holy Ghost, they're synonymous. They mean the same thing. And he's talking about God is a spirit. So if you really, really, really wanted to pull away, and I'm making a point here, if you really wanted to pull away everything that God is, I mean, get to the raw root of who he is, like what you see now is not the real me. What I'm looking at right here, Brandon, it's not the real him. It, you pull the rug off and the wool off and the skin off and everything else off, and you get to the root of who I am. If you did that with God, what you would find out is that he is omnipresent. He's everywhere at the same time. He does not dwell in time. He has no beginning of days nor end of days. He never had a beginning. He never started somewhere. He is in the past. He is in the present, and he's in the future all at the same time. He is a spirit, one singular spirit. And see, that one singular spirit is God. And Jesus is God. And God is God. So how is that? Because he cannot be separated, really, in the whole grand scheme of things. He cannot be separated. So he overshadowed Mary, and she was with child, because the father of Jesus is the father. But it was the Spirit that gave the ability for her to become pregnant. And how is that? Because the Spirit is this God that I'm talking about. I saw a hand back here. Pastor Robinson? Luke. Correct. The Holy One inside of you is going to be called the Son of God, which, in other words, he's going to be actually begotten. Someone said it over here, begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. It was because his Father was the Father. Although we are all called, and when we come in, we're adopted in the family, we're called sons and daughters of God. Daughters are called sons of God too, because there's only sonship. So we're called sons of God. Even ladies are called sons of God. We call them daughters of God, but they're actually sons of God. So every one of us are, in that sense, in Adam being a son of God, but Jesus was the only begotten of the Father. That's what distinctly makes him distinctly different, is he doesn't have an earthly father, neither did Adam, but Jesus was begotten of God. Not Adam was formed from something that was created, which is the dust of the ground. Jesus wasn't formed from anything. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good statement to make. He said, "It begotten is only found in the King James Bible, but not in any other versions." Okay, let me give you a little breakdown on the versions, so that you'll understand about King James versus versions. All other versions actually derive their teaching and putting together from the King James Version. Every single one of them. There's not one that's separate from that. But other versions have chosen to exalt other manuscripts over the authorized text. But they do it in a way that is like what he just said. They delete words or they leave out phrases and then they explain why. Let me explain it to you why. I said this, I think, on the last lesson, but you've got all these manuscripts. When they put the manuscripts together, about 5,800 or so, they put them all together. They said, let's go through them and find out where the Word of God is. Well, 80 to 90% of those manuscripts agreed 100%. A scribe, let's use the young guys. Okay, you're the scribe, Levi. You go over there and sit down. Caleb, go on the platform. AJ, you stand right here next to Levi. So, he's the scribe. And I'm handing him a manuscript. This is how all manuscripts had to be done. Because they're copies of copies of copies of copies. We have no originals, okay, from the time when Job was around. Okay? But we do have something that goes back into the time of Isaiah. And so here we go. We give this to Levi because he's a scribe. How do I know he's a scribe? Well, Levi's going to open this. He's going to have another scribe who is a bona fide scribe, a real scribe. And Levi is going to write one letter, only a letter, one character. And as he writes, going to write one character, and then say J out loud.
J.
And then the other scribe is going to look at what he wrote, and he's going to say J. J. And the other one's going to look, and he's going to make sure that that's what he did. And then he's going to say number one. Say number one.
Number one.
Number one.
And he's going to verify. Here's the point. This is the process that a scribe used, and there were other things as well. But this is one of the processes they used to make sure that what they were doing, that they were not corrupting the text, they weren't adding into it, they were actual scribes. They had to make sure what they were copying was authentic so that when they gave it to the next generation, because God said he would preserve his word for all generations. They wanted to make sure, doubly sure, that what they were giving to the next generation was going to hold up. So by the time, thank you guys, by the time the manuscripts came to us, King James, we didn't have it in English. We had all these other versions going on, all these other translations, I say. We had all these other translations out there. He took all those translations. He took all those manuscripts. He got the over 40 scholars together, and he said, go through every manuscript, and I want you to do it as and do it as the scribes would do it. In other words, go through it. If there's any mistakes, words missing, like that, I want you to throw the manuscript out or just throw it to the side. It's really what they did. Throw it to the side. And the ones that agree 100%, put them in, and what they called, when they put it in, they did this. They called it the authorized text or the received text. It's called the Textus Receptus. It's called the majority text because the majority of manuscripts that agreed, they came up with this. Everything else was called the minority text. Later on, a guy by the name of Westcott and his buddy Hort, they came along. And they thought, man, they found a manuscript in the Vatican. They also, it was in a library, and they found another one. I forget where it was, but it was in a garbage can. And they found it, and they went through it. They were scholars, and they went through it, and they said, man, this is the Word of God. But when King James had it, they knew that it had scriptures in it, but they set it aside because there were whole passages of scripture missing in it. And some things were distorted. There were mistakes in the words. And a real scribe, like these guys, wouldn't make those mistakes. So they couldn't get in the mind of the scribes. All they knew is that a real scribe wouldn't have done that. So they set it to the side. So there was something that was going on here. Either a real scribe didn't put this together, or there was a guy, a scribe, or a person who was trying to corrupt the text. And they called it the minority text. And one was the Vaticanus, and one was called the Sinaiticus. The Vaticanus and the Sinaiticus have become your greatest models of the modern theologians. When they get it now, they're just like salivating because they are older texts, but they're salivating because it's a shorter reading, number one. And number two, it takes away some of the spiritualness out of the Bible, okay? So it's mainly gendering to the flesh. So more than likely, whoever corrupted it or whoever put it together like that was more fleshly. They didn't believe in all the miracles. They didn't believe in all the signs and wonders. They didn't believe in any of that kind of stuff. Like this Pharisees and the Sadducees. The Pharisees were fair, you see, because they believed in the resurrection and divine healing and all that. And the Sadducees were sad, you see, because they didn't believe in the resurrection of the dead. They didn't believe in miracles, signs, and wonders, see? The Pharisees believed in it. Sadducees didn't believe. That's how you remember it. That's how I learned it years ago. Begotten means you came to being in time at some point. Okay. So when they brought in the talking about this begotten, when taking out different things, it's not bad that it's not there, but to say I'm going to hang my hat on it when it's in there. Here's one good thing about King James, what they did. And sometimes the reading is harder. Now, I read a lot of versions, so you know that. You know I read a lot of versions, and I'll use a lot of versions. I'm not against versions. You just need to know what you're dealing with. And so it's not that it's bad. It's just that you, when you're reading it and it comes to one of those places, you have to understand that there was a mindset, and you read in the footnotes, there's a mindset that when they put it together, that they believed and they used the same majority text, but then they began to really operate in the minority text with their footnotes and with different things like that. So in the text, in the footnotes, they'll write in there, well, in the older, here's the terms that they use, and this is the type of language they use. They said in the older manuscripts or more reliable manuscripts, Mark chapter 16, verse so-and-so to so-and-so was not in the original older manuscript. So the guy that's got any intellect will say, really? Let me investigate that. And then he'll go to those older manuscripts that he's talking about. And of course, it goes back to Sinaiticus and Vaticanus. And they go in there and they look at that and they say, that's true. And what's wrong with that? But then they begin to say, it's not necessary. That's why in most theological seminaries that you go in, they do not believe in signs and wonders and miracles or anything like that in higher education. That's why sometimes these guys that come out of there are really messed up. And that's why Bible colleges are good, because Bible colleges give you the meat and bones of what you need. But then when you get into higher education, you need to go in there with a good foundation, because they can totally sway you to believe that, man, you know, there's no, that really didn't happen, or that's all allegorical, that isn't really what God meant. You need to believe that we have the Word of God. Okay? We do have it. Any other questions on that before we move on? Yes, comment.
I've never really heard it explained like that, like this in-depth studies of the Bible. I made my mind up. I'm not reading that, but King James.
Right.
But in my mind, I always knew, okay, I hear people quoting from some other translation. It does help.
Right.
But like you said, it's good to know the King James and what God is doing. The Holy Ghost, we're able to see.
Right.
Where things get crazy.
Yeah, you'll see things missing that's totally gone. And you'll say, well, what does that mean? How did they come to that? And I'm telling you how they came to that. The minority text, which is two manuscripts. The minority text started taking over as you started going on. But if you look back, I used to have a little graph that I used to show, because I used to teach on this every once in a while. But this graph that I would show, you have all these bars, okay? Every bar goes upon another bar. Everything's built on something. And you saw that the Bishop's Bible and the Wycliffe Bible and all these other Bibles and translations, King James, if you looked at the graph, King James is like on all of them. Then when you get to like New International Version, it's like bypassing a whole bunch of stuff and just going straight over to something else. And bypassing, it goes to King James and it bypasses a lot of things and it kind of stands frail. And most people don't know what they're looking at. But I had it in my Bible for a long time because I wanted to, you could see these poles, one thing led on another. One thing I liked about the King James, it was built and built and built on a great foundation. These other versions, they came off King, they leap off of King James, but then some of them leap into the abyss. They go straight to the Sinaiticus and the Vaticanus. And that's where they get their roots and that's where they dig down deep. So it's hard to tell them something that they'll say, that wasn't in the original. Well, the originals, you know, if you want some originals, you'd have to go back and be there yourself and be a scholar and be able to break it down and understand it. But I'm trusting, based upon what the Lord said, that he would preserve his word. He would keep his word. He would make sure that we have it for all generation. I'm trusting that he left us with a reliable witness. And I like the process, and that's everything, the process in which they came about with the King James Version. I use other versions for clarity, but I like the process that they used to get where they got. These other guys, these modern scholars, they're not using a good process. Okay, they're really not. Yes? Right. 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 Yeah, it becomes clear. But at the same time, I'm not a King James only guy. To the point that if you can't read any other version other than King James, that's what I mean by that. I love King James. When I quote out of King James. But I'm not a King James only guy. In other words, saying you can't get the word of God here or there. You can. I'm just trying to tell you, go in with your eyes wide open. Why would you walk in blind like this? Go in with your eyes wide open and understand where they're coming from, what they're trying to accomplish, and what they're trying to do. Okay, and then once you have that, then you understand, I can look at this and judge it. So when you see passages of scripture missing, or you see a distortion, why isn't that word in there? Why was verse 8, they don't even have a verse 8? What's that all about? I mean, verses came later, and chapters came later. It was all written one text. I know that. But when the verses were given, why is verse 8 of some scriptures not even there? They'd go right to verse 15. What's that all about? I had a question back here with the phone. Right. Yeah. Well, the Message Bible is not a Bible. The Message Bible is a paraphrase of the Bible. In other words, there's somebody's thoughts, just like the Good News Bible is not a Bible. The Good News and the paraphrase Bibles are not Bibles. They're just paraphrasing something as they wrote. The Good News guy, he wasn't a scholar at all. The Good News Bible guy who wrote that, he wasn't even a scholar at all. He just wrote for his grandkid, or I think it was a grandkid or his kid, one of the two, that he wrote it for them, and then he published it. So those are paraphrasing more than a version. A version is actual scholarly work that they put together and they came out with a version based upon the majority text, and then they kind of, a lot of them branched off into the minority text, kind of simplified to you. Any other questions, comments, or anything on that before we move on?
Yeah,
Yes, Brother Tony, quickly. I mean, you should trust and have an open mind, but at the same time, be biblical, line upon line, precept upon precept. You know, that's not something that as Christians we should fight about. It's something you should have knowledge about. Amen? Number two, we said Jesus was identified as the Son of God according to Vine's Expository Dictionary of New Testament Words. It says, in this title, the word son is used sometimes of relationship, sometimes of expression of character. When the disciples so addressed him, speaking of Jesus, in Matthew chapter 16, verse 16, they probably meant that he was a manifestation of God in human form. So when you saw Jesus, the Son of the living God, they're saying that we were looking at God himself in human form. Now that was the big issue. I know some will say, well, they were mad because Jesus was saying this or trying to make himself exalted among other religious leaders and that kind of thing. But that's not what they got mad at Jesus about. They got mad and they said it specifically because you not only said that you're Messiah, you not only say you're the Christ, but now you're saying you're the Son of the living God. He says you're making yourself equal with God on the same plane. Same battlefield, on the same level. See, the thing about it is, and I said it, and I think I was saying it when I was preaching this past weekend or whenever, that God has no equal, and God has no subordinates in the sense that someone's God and they're subordinate to him.
Hallelujah.
Okay? That's right. There's no, I'm God and you're God, but you're subordinate to me.
Right.
Can't be. Because again, someone will not be God. But God has to only be equal to himself. Everything, and if I had time, I'd go in it. When God communes with things, he communes with things based upon his own counsel. Ephesians chapter 1 talks about it. I think it's verse 6 through 8, somewhere around there. That it says that he counsels after the counsel of his own will. In other words, he has a conversation within himself. We know Jesus is the wisdom of God and he is the express image of the invisible God. But even when God is talking outside of this world, I don't believe he's talking to angels. In other words, conversing with angels. What should we do? And he doesn't deal with it. Angels are there to serve. Angels have a purpose and angels have a design, what they were designed for. And they minister or they carry out God's plans or they give messages of that sort. But he begins to counsel. Go with me to Proverbs chapter 8. I believe it is. Proverbs chapter 8. Now the whole premise here is talking about wisdom and it's talking about fear the Lord, the knowledge, and all that kind of stuff. So I'm kind of cutting to the chase. And it says, doth in verse chapter 8, verse 1, it says, doth not wisdom cry and understanding put, notice, forth her voice? So right from the beginning, we're talking about God giving it a female attribute. Okay? Her. Okay? Female. She standeth in the top of high places, by the way in places, and in the way of the paths. She crieth at the gates, at the entry of the city, at the coming in at the doors. Go on down to verse 12. It says, I, wisdom. Everybody say wisdom.
Wisdom.
Okay? It says, I, wisdom. Now wisdom has a persona. It's a lady, but now it has a persona. It has a life of its own. And it says, I, wisdom, speaking for itself, dwell with prudence and find out knowledge of witty inventions. The fear of the Lord, and the word Lord here, you'll notice in the King James and other versions that may not have it, but the King James is good because sometimes it adds things in here that'll tell you exactly what it's talking about. It's the tetragrammaton, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, meaning God, Jehovah, Yahweh. It's talking about him exclusively. It's talking about the I am. It's talking about him right here. It says, even I, notice, A fear of the Lord, or tetragrammaton, is to hate evil, pride, and arrogancy, and the evil way, and the forward mouth do I hate. He said, counsel is mine, talking about wisdom, and sound wisdom. I am, notice, understanding. Now, interjecting another character here. I have strength. By me, kings reign, and princes decree justice. By me, princes rule, and nobles, even all the judges of the earth. Notice, I love them that love me. Who? Love me what? Understanding and wisdom. They love me. Those that seek me early shall find me. Riches and honor are with me, yea, durable riches and righteousness. My fruit is better than gold, yea, than fine gold. My revenue than choice silver. I lead in the way of righteousness in the midst of the paths of judgment, that I may cause those, notice, that love me, wisdom, to inherit substance. And I will fill their treasures. The Lord, who was all by himself, according to Isaiah, the Lord was all by himself, didn't know anybody beside him, nobody with him, that he did all these things by himself. Notice, the Lord possessed me in the beginning of his ways, before his works of old. I was set up, I mean, I came into being. I was set up from everlasting, from the beginning, or ever the earth was. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no fountains abounding with water, before the mountains were settled, before the hills was I brought forth. While as yet, and again, we're talking about a female attribute, while as yet he had not made the earth, nor the fields, nor the highest part of the dust. He's talking wisdom, talking about something separate than himself. He says, or the fields of the dust of the world, when he prepared the heavens, talking about the tetragrammaton, talking about God, talking about our Father. He says, when he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he set a compass upon the face of the depth, when he established the clouds above, when he strengthened the fountains of the deep, when he gave the sea his decree that the water should not pass his commandment, when he appointed the fountains of the earth, here's the crux of the matter. Then I was with him, I was by him as one brought up with him. I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him. Now, it speaks in the terms as though wisdom was this gal and understanding, and they're just rejoicing before the Lord, and they're just having a good old time, and they're conversing with the Lord. They came forth, they were brought out, they were rejoicing and praising God with him as before he even made the earth and all these other things. But wisdom is who he is. It's part of his character. And that's what makes sense when you go to Ephesians chapter 1 and it talks about it, that he counsels after the counsel of his own will. It's not like him talking to himself, but he calculates everything without conversing with anybody. He doesn't even communicate with mankind unless it's for our good. He said, if I needed anything, I would not ask you. Because you can't give God. You can't add anything to God. We can't add or take away. You need to know that. We can't add to God, and we cannot subtract from God. If I choose never to believe in God, it's not going to make one little jolt in heaven, because he changes not. Everybody with me? I don't want to get too far into it. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, I'm reading from the Amplified Classic Version. And great and important and weighty, or without argument, we confess, is the hidden truth or the mystic secret of godliness. God, or he, speaking of God, was made visible in human flesh, justified and vindicated in the Holy Spirit, was seen by angels, preached among the nations, believed on in the world, and taken up in glory. We're talking about who? Jesus. Anybody have another suggestion who that was? Okay. According to that scripture, get the other ones. But to that one, who was Jesus? God? Anybody have any other suggestions? Who? Elijah? Anybody else? According to Sister Chan? Three person in one? Father, Son, Holy Ghost? Talk about that. Anybody else? According to this, God, now let's say this, whatever God is, and whoever God is, was manifest. In other words, revealed in the flesh. So when you say God is manifest in the flesh, whoever God is and whatever God is became, according to this scripture, a human being. Alistair McGrath wrote a book years ago called Understanding the Trinity. He was writing this book to persuade his Trinitarian brethren to quit it with all the three thrones and the three persons and the way they were talking about persons. Quit it. And he was the second most leading Trinitarian theologian in the world. And in his book, he was saying, away with the threes and ones and this and that. He said, here's the bottom line. You have to understand that when Tertullian, who was a Catholic scholar who coined the word Trinity, he said God is three persons, not in the sense that he is three people in the modern sense. He said he is three persons in the sense of persona, in other words, like an actor on a stage. And the actor on the stage, like they did in old time, would put on a mask and portray himself as something, and remove the mask and portray himself as something else, and remove the mask and portray himself as this. But when you took the mask off, McGrath said, when you took the mask off, there was only one actor, and that actor is God. He said, so when you come in here, he went on to say, when you come in contact with God, you must come in contact with Jesus and the Holy Ghost. He said, when you come in contact with Jesus, you are coming in contact with God, and the Holy Ghost is God. He said, you cannot come in contact with God without contacting all of what God is. Here's what happened when we say Father God, Jesus, or God is Father, Son, Holy Ghost. He is a Father, He is a Son, and He is the Holy Ghost. Totally agreed. But He was manifest in the body of Jesus Christ. And in Colossians chapter 2, it tells us that all the fullness in its completeness of the Godhead, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, all the fullness of Godhead dwelleth in Him, speaking of Christ, Jesus, bodily, in bodily form. That's why Jesus could say when in John chapter 14, if you encounter me, if you look upon me, because he said, I'm going away, I'm making mansions, and I'm going to prepare a place for you where I am, you can come too, and we're going to be together forever. And they said, and the Father, and I'm going back to the Father, and my Father's house are many mansions and all this. And they said, oh, Jesus, show us the Father, that it sufficeth us, it will satisfy us. And he said, have I been so long time with you that you don't know me, Philip? He that has seen me, laid eyes on me, has seen the Father. He said, don't you believe that the Father's in me and I in the Father? If you don't believe that, me saying that, he said, believe it for the very works that I do. It's the Father in me. He doeth the works. Colossians chapter 5, in around verse 19, it says that it talks about, to wit, a legal term. It says, to wit, God was in Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one, the man. God was in the human being, manifest in the flesh. God was in Christ, notice, reconciling the world to himself. He used the vehicle of Jesus to bring men to him. He had to come as a man to redeem men. It couldn't be by just a human being born of a woman and born under a man. It had to be a man born from above, a begotten. And when he came down himself, all of God did not come. But when you encounter Jesus, you do encounter God. Fast forward to the end of time. Two things I want to show you. End of time. There's going to be one throne in heaven and one that sits on the throne. Now, in Dates, Dates wasn't a scholar. He wrote a Bible. Date, if you ever read, it's called Dates Bible. He's not a scholar, but he wrote one. And it was very popular in this day. Dates says, and if you ever read to the back, if you go in the library sometimes and look at Dates, and you look at and read, he's got three thrones there and three little halos going on there. He was rejected by his brethren and of his day because he said, you're a tritheist. In other words, you believe in three separate gods, three separate people that you're going to worship throughout eternity. And he had these three thrones. But that's an idea that they get. And that's normal to get that idea. But here he is. There's only one throne in heaven, the Bible tells us in Revelation. And only one that sits on the throne. My question to you, dear brothers and sisters of the cloth. Who's on the throne? God. Anybody else? Jesus. Anybody else? Messiah. The Son of Man. Looks like the Son of Man. The point is this. Identify the one on the throne. There's only one throne in heaven and one that sits on the throne. I submit to you that it is Jesus who overcame, that God lives in forever and is walking through eternity with, and we encounter him. Let me give you another scripture. Revelation chapter 21. It says, Behold, the tabernacle of God. Now that word tabernacle simply means tent. If I were to set up a tent right here, or a hut, or a dwelling place. That word tabernacle is the same word tabernacle that's used in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 in the very beginning, where it says 1 through 4, 1 through 3, something like that. It talks about us in our earthen tabernacles, you know, our bodies. We do groan and we want to be clothed upon from heaven, but we don't want to die, but we want God to put us in his. We do groan in these earthen tabernacles. It uses that same terminology in Revelation chapter 21, where it says, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. It's talking about God himself being that tabernacle with men. The tabernacle of God is with men, and he will wipe away all their tears and the pain and all the sorrow and everything's going to be gone. That's going to be all. Former things are going to pass away and all things are going to become new. And then it says these words. It says, and God himself shall be with them. Now, it's not going to be this God himself is going to be with them and they're just kind of believing that God is like he is right now, invisible. The invisible, because Jesus is the express image of the invisible God, the invisible will become visible in the tabernacle of Jesus Christ. He tabernacled in Christ to bring men to God. And then at all end of all times, behold, the tabernacle or the body or the tent of God is going to be revealed to men. And God will be with them and they shall be his people and he shall be their God. And he'll never leave them again because Jesus, the one seated on the throne, will be with them. The Son of God, the Messiah, the Christ. Any questions or thoughts or anything on that? Brother Tony. You're welcome. Oh, you're welcome. Amen. Going back just a little bit. God is going to reveal himself to mankind, not just to carry on a relationship throughout eternity with just spirit, but he wants to be personal. And this is why Jesus is one of the reasons why Jesus had to come, is that this personal relationship, you'll be able to identify with him. The nail prints in his hand, the side. He still has those things, you know. He has them there to identify that I'm the one that overcame. Third thing, and we want to end with this. The third thing, Jesus was identified as, someone said in here, the Word of God. John chapter 1, verse 1, amplified. In the beginning, before all time, was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God Himself. And the Word, in verse 14, notice, and the Word became flesh and lived among us. And it goes on to say, in King James, we beheld His glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. But my focus here is on the Word. The Word. Everybody say the Word. So He was the Word. He was more than just the Word. We notice that He was Christ. He's the Son of God. And He is the Word of God. The Word, W-O-R-D, it has a lot of meanings, but I just extracted a few here that, you know, resonate with me. But they're all intrinsic of the person, okay? They're part of the person, okay? They're not something separate from the person. If you look at this word, which is called logos, the word logos word comes from the Greek word logos, and it means some of these things that I'm getting ready to say. But it was part of the person, okay? Logos wasn't something that was outside of the person, because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. One person tried to say, okay, well, the God there is talking about God the Father, and the Word there is talking about God the Son. Well, okay, let's use that logic, because that's faulty logic. First semester logic, it doesn't work even here. Listen, let's use that logic. In the beginning was God the Son, and in the beginning was the Word, and God the Son was with God the Father. And God the Son was God the Father. That's how we read. So your logic of trying to establish that there's two individuals here at play doesn't work. The point is, in the beginning was the Word, and Word was with God, and the Word was God, part of whoever God is. God Himself, it says in the Amplified. The Word comes from a Greek word, logos, which means the mind. You write that on your study guide. And one of the blanks, the first blank, the mind, plan, thought, expression, intent, or utterance of God. All of it was part of who God is. In other words, let's look at on the young men here. Stand up for a second. You don't mind me using you for a second? This young man, say your name again.
Diego.
Diego is made up of three parts, just like God. He was made in God's image. He was made after God's likeness. God is Father, Son, Holy Ghost, but you can't separate them. But somehow this Word that was inside him stepped out. But notice, he was made in His image after His likeness. He is body, soul, and spirit. Well, you say body, soul, and spirit can't be separated. Yes, it can. The Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing of soul and spirit, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Paul said, I pray your whole soul, body, and spirit be preserved blameless in 2 Thessalonians chapter 5. I pray that your whole body, soul, and spirit, or soul, body, and spirit, be preserved blameless unto the coming of the Lord. So in other words, this body, this soul, and this spirit can be separated by the Word of God. When he dies, his spirit goes back to God who gave it. His soul is connected to his spirit. It goes out there. The body goes back to the earth from whence he came. Okay, it goes back to the dust. But it can be separated. But when you talk about Jesus being who he is, you got to understand that somehow, in the beginning was the Word. Very beginning of time was the Word. The mind, the plan, the thought, the expression, the intent. The very Word of God. And the Word was with God. But not only that, the Word was God, because it's part of just like him. But the Word, here's the thing that was the mystery. Here's, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. Without argument, how did God become a man? How did his Word that spoke everything into existence, created by the Word of God, of Hebrews chapter 1 tells us, all things that you see now were created by the Word of God. The spoken Word of God. And so when we're talking about this mystery, or God becoming a man, he spoke things into existence, but it's that Word, that logos, that became flesh and dwelt among us. So he's not only the Son of God, he's not only the Christ, but he's also the Word of God. Okay? And number four, final thing, try and get you out of here. Jesus was identified as the I Am. The I Am. Everybody say the I Am. Okay, that means he is. He was. He will always be. It depends on where you're coming from with him. That's what it is. The I Am is. It covers all grounds. Jesus said in John chapter 8, verse 58, they were debating with Jesus, and he said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was," because they were saying, "You're not even 50 years old, and you said that Abraham rejoices to see your day." Abraham's dead and gone. He said, "You're not even 50 years old." He told these people, and I don't have time to go through the whole story, but he told them that, "Look, Abraham, your father, rejoices to see my day." And they said, "We know Abraham's our father, but you're not even 50. You're 30. Aren't you 30 years old? 33, something like that?" And he said, "How are you, Abraham? How is Abraham rejoicing to see your day? And you're not even 50?" He said, "Before Abraham was, I am." Now, according to theologians, the two words used here are "I am," meaning "I am the one who is the Lord," or the tetragrammaton, the Hebrew Yahweh. So Jesus wasn't just saying, "I am as great as you," or however you want to say it. Jesus was saying, "I am Yahweh. I am the tetragrammaton." That, you know what they did right after he said that? If it was just any kind of guy just saying, or any kind of words coming out of his mouth, they would have just said, "Yeah, whatever." But he was blaspheming. He was using blasphemous words by saying he was God himself. He used words, and what did they do next? Anybody know what they did next? They picked up stones to stone him to death. What he said, if it was not true, in their day, was worthy of death. It was the death penalty. Because he was saying, "I am the one who is the Lord." Hebrew, Yahweh. 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 The roots of Jesus' statements is tracked back to last scripture here. It's tracked back to Exodus chapter 3, verse 13 through 15. Notice what it says. Verse 13. Moses said unto God, this is when he's going to go back to Egypt, right? "When I come unto the children of Israel and say unto them, the God of your fathers has sent me unto you. And they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses out of the burning bush," he said, "I am," same words that Jesus used, "I am that I am." I'm the self-existing one. I am Jehovah. I am Yahweh. I am the one that's over all of it. And he said, "Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am has sent me unto you." And God said, moreover, unto Moses, thou shalt say unto the children of Israel, "The Lord your God, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me unto you. This is my name, the I Am, forever. And this is my memorial unto all generations." So when Jesus spoke with those group of religious leaders, and he said, "Before Abraham was, I am," he was saying, "I'm not only the first and the last. I'm not only the Alpha and the Omega. I'm not only the Good Shepherd. I'm not only the door and the way. I'm not only any of these places where you can put I am to that's in the scripture. I'm all that and a bag of chips." But he said, "I am the one that spoke out of the burning bush that brought you out of Egypt and have given you Abraham as your father. As worthy of a stone." Or to us, it should be worthy of praise. That the one you serve today is none other than God manifest in the flesh. Amen. Let's all stand here tonight. And let's pray that God would give us understanding, give us joy, give us peace. But let us understand who we're serving. We're not just serving a demigod. That means a lesser God, or someone that says they're like God, but they're just a little bit below God. Not a second person of God. He has no second tier in his kingdom. You're either God or you're not. We're serving Almighty God who came down to us in the manifestation, in the form of a man, through the person of Jesus Christ. And we have a relationship with God through him. And without accepting his humanity, you'll never get to the deity. But if you want the deity, you've got to accept the humanity. And when you accept the humanity, you get the deity by proxy. You get it automatically. It's just part of the deal. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. And I pray for us, Lord, at Lighthouse, and I pray for us that are striving to walk with you, that God, we will know you better. Let us come into a great relationship with Jesus that we might know you the way we're supposed to. We don't understand all the makeup of who you are, but here's what we do know. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to you except through him. Lord, we need to understand his humanity as well as we need to understand his deity. Help us to understand the Word of God. Help us to understand the Son of God. Help us to understand God manifest in the flesh. Help us to understand the tabernacle of God. Help us to understand how you're made up and what you're all about. Lord, let us glorify you in the earth. Let us not fight with one another, but Lord, sharpen each other for the kingdom. Because God, one day we're coming home. And there's only one throne in heaven and one that sits on the throne. Oh, we'll see the one with the nail-scarred hands. We'll see the one with the eyes of the flames of fire. We'll see the one with the hair white like wool. We'll see the one walking in the midst of the candlesticks. We'll see the one with his feet like they're brown, like they've been burned in a furnace. His voice will be like many waters. We'll see Jesus, who is the head of the church. We'll see Jesus, who is the first and the last. We will see Jesus, who on his thigh, on his vesture is written the word of God, King of kings and Lord of lords. I pray in the name of Jesus that God, we will not sell you short, Lord, nor will we try and figure you all the way out, but help us to learn and grow and help us to be in the kingdom when it's time to come in. Lord, let us teach each other and teach men about your kingdom and teach them, Lord, that one day you're coming back for us. And Lord, when we begin to think about your name is a mighty strong tower, and the righteous run into it and they are safe. Your name shall be called Emmanuel, which is interpreted God with us. Oh, you're going to be the God that we're looking for, Jesus. We ask you, Lord, your name is Jesus, Jehovah Savior, Jehovah Salvation, or Jehovah has become our salvation. Lord, we lift you up in this place and we say, Lord, have your way. You're the King of all kings and Lord of all lords. You're the Prince of all princes. You're the Prince of peace. You're everything we need. I pray for our children as they grow up, Lord God. They'll learn about you. They'll thirst for you, Lord, and they'll grow in the knowledge and understanding of you, Lord, that they would want to serve Jesus with everything they have and with all confidence in who he is. That's all I got to declare, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. Say in Jesus' name. Come on and put your hands together one more time. Hallelujah. God bless you. Greet each other as you go. Go in the name of the Lord and thank you for being here tonight.